The goal of this screencast is to provide an example of a combustion problem that includes both complete and partial combustion. In this case, the combustible species is ethane. We'll touch on basic reaction concepts such as degrees of freedom analysis for multiple reactions. We'll also touch on specific ideas to combustion, which are the percent excess of air and the wet and dry basis of the stat gas. The reaction stoichiometry for ethane is shown. The first reaction, we have the complete combustion of ethane, where carbon is converted to carbon dioxide. The second reaction shows the partial combustion of ethane, where carbon is converted to carbon monoxide. In this problem, we're given a couple pieces of information. We're going to assume a basis of 100 moles of ethane, which is labeled on the process flowchart. We know that there's 50% excess air that's fed to the reactor, so we don't know how much, but we know the ratio relative to the feed. We also know the composition of air is always 21% oxygen, 79% nitrogen. With this information, we want to find the ratio of water to the dry gas in the stat gas, which is the reactor output. If we look at the output, the stat gas, we can find all the components that could possibly make up the output. So the first three species are all reaction products. We also have unreacted oxygen, the inert nitrogen from air, and any unreacted ethane that might be present. Based on the information that's been given, let's do the degrees of freedom analysis using both molecular species balances and atomic species balances to see if we have enough information to fully characterize the stat gas and calculate the ratio that's been asked for. The degrees of freedom is equal to the number of unknowns minus the number of equations that we can write to relate them. This analysis is important. We want 0 degrees of freedom so that we can ensure ourselves that we have enough equations that we can write to solve for all the unknowns in the process. We can apply this analysis to both the molecular species as well as the atomic species. So we'll start with molecular. Looking at the flowchart, we have 6 variables that represent the species in the stat gas, and we also don't know how much air is fed to the reactor. So we have a total of 7 unknowns. In this case, there are 5 molecular species that are reactive. We're not including nitrogen that's inert, but we can also write a mole balance on nitrogen. We have 1 other equation, which is the percent excess, that relates how much air is fed relative to the ethane feed. Taking the difference between equations and unknown here shows 0 degrees of freedom, but we have not accounted for the degrees of freedom associated with each reaction. Each independent reaction adds 1 degree of freedom to the process, which essentially accounts for the extent of reaction. For each reaction, we don't know the extent to which the reaction has proceeded. So if we tally up our unknowns and our equations that we can use to relate them, in this case we have 2 degrees of freedom, which implies that we need 2 more things to be specified before we can calculate for all the variables in this chart. Let's take a look at how that changes if we look at the atomic species. In this case, we still have 7 unknowns that we're trying to solve for, and we can write 3 atomic species balances, which include carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen. We also have the inert balance for nitrogen, and we still have our 1 other equation, which represents the percent excess. In this case, we don't have any degrees of freedom for the atomic species because atomic species are conserved. There's no extent of reaction or consumption or generation to account for when we're talking about atomic species. So in this case, we have 2 degrees of freedom as well. So either way we look at this problem, we need 2 more pieces of information before we can find what's asked for, which is the ratio of water to dry gas in the reactor output. In this case, we already know the percent excess of air, and we'll also assume a fractional conversion of ethane of 0.9. Of the ethane that reacts, 30% is going to form carbon monoxide. We can start by using the definition of percent excess of air to find out how much air is fed to the reactor per 100 moles of ethane. It's important to keep in mind that when we're finding the percent excess of air, it is only based on complete combustion. By definition, the percent excess is equal to the moles fed to the reactor minus the moles that are theoretically required to consume all of the fuel divided by the theoretical requirement. From the complete combustion chemistry, we can first find out the theoretical number of moles of oxygen that are required to react with all the ethane. From the complete combustion stoichiometry, we can see that for 100 moles of ethane, we're going to need 3.5 times that number of moles of oxygen to completely react. So if we multiply our 100 moles by 7/2, we get 350 moles of oxygen that are theoretically required. We can find the theoretical amount of air that's required to deliver our 350 moles of oxygen if we take into account that a mole of air contains 0.21 moles of oxygen. So multiplying 350 by a mole of air per 0.21 moles of oxygen gives us 1,667 moles of air that are theoretically required to deliver the necessary oxygen. Plugging in these numbers to the equation for percent excess, if we have 50% excess, that's equal to the amount of air that we're actually feeding to the reactor minus our theoretical requirement of 1,667 divided by 1,667. So in this case, our flow rate of air is equal to 2,500 moles. Next, we can use the specified fractional conversion to find how much ethane is leaving the reactor. The fractional conversion represents, for the number of moles that go into the reactor, how many of them have reacted. Here, the fractional conversion is represented with the variable F. Fractional conversion can be calculated by taking the difference between what goes in and what goes out, which represents the number of moles that have reacted, and relating that to the number of moles that go in. Here we've specified our conversion as 0.9, and we have 100 moles going in. Our variable for the ethane leaving is N6, so this calculation shows that N6 is equal to 10 moles of ethane. This also shows us that 90 moles of ethane have reacted, which we can use to find the number of moles of carbon monoxide leaving the reactor. The moles of carbon monoxide leaving the reactor is given the variable N2, and we know that that's equal to 30% of the number of moles of ethane that have been reacted, which in this case is 90. If we look at the reaction stoichiometry, though, we know that for every mole of ethane that's consumed, 2 moles of carbon dioxide are generated. So we need to multiply by that molar ratio. This calculation shows that we have 54 moles of carbon monoxide leaving the reactor. Scrolling down here a little bit, I've relabeled our flowchart to include the values of moles of air, ethane, and carbon monoxide that we previously found. We can see here that we still have 4 unknowns to solve for, which means that we're going to have to set up a system of mole balances to solve for the remaining unknowns. We can either do this via molecular species balances or atomic species balances. It's important to keep in mind each independent reaction has its own extent of reaction. In this case, we have 2 reactions, so we have 2 extents, and these essentially represent additional variables that would have to be solved for. Anytime there's more than one reaction, it's generally easier to set up a system of atomic species balances, which is what we'll do here. The principle of an atomic species balance is that atomic species are conserved, so the balances can be written in the form of N equals out. And we can write that for every atom that's involved in the reactions. In this case, that includes carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen. We'll start with carbon and the number of carbon atoms that are entering the reactor. We have 100 moles of ethane and 2 moles of carbon for every mole of ethane. So 2 times 100 must be equal to the carbon leaving. We have 1 mole of carbon for every mole of carbon dioxide, so we have N1 plus the moles of carbon monoxide, which also has 1 carbon, so plus 54. Plus 2 moles of carbon for every mole of ethane leaving, which is 2 times 10. We can repeat this process for hydrogen and oxygen. Counting up the atoms of hydrogen and oxygen entering and leaving the reactor should lead to the following system of equations. In this case, we can solve these very easily sequentially, which can be used to calculate N1, N3, and N4. The only thing we haven't solved for is N5, which represents the amount of nitrogen leaving the reactor. In this case, nitrogen's inert, so the nitrogen that enters the reactor with air passes through unreacted. So we can simply write a mole balance also of the form N equals out. So in this case, N5 is equal to 0.79 times the molar flow rate of air, which is 2,500. So we should have 1,975 moles of nitrogen that are leaving the reactor. In the original problem statement, we were asked to find the ratio of water to dry gas in the stat gas. And we now know the molar amounts of every component in the stat gas, so we should be able to find this ratio. The stat gas is often expressed on a dry basis or a wet basis. So if we're looking for the dry gas content, it essentially represents everything in the stat gas without water. So we're essentially being asked to find the moles of water related to the moles of everything in the stat gas except for water. From the atom balances, we found that we have 270 moles of water in the stat gas. If we want to find the total amount of dry gas we have, we need to find the total moles of the stat gas and subtract the amount of water. If we add up the total number of moles, we find that we have 2,672 moles in the stat gas. And taking out the 270 moles of water gives us 2,402 moles of dry gas. If we take the ratio of 270 to 2,402, we find that the ratio is 0.112, which is essentially a metric of the humidity content on a dry air basis.